with me. Listen. I believe I got. That's why I dance, rejoice, and sing.
Yeah. I believe
the Savior came with the purpose to reclaim, and there is power in His name. Yeah.
Yeah. Our pastor, Valerie Holcomb, would like to welcome back our Christian House of Prayer family and welcome all of our first-time and returning visitors. We pray that today you'll experience the light, life, and love of God during this service. Again, we say welcome and hope to see you again real soon, right here at the Christian House of Prayer Ministries, where it's all about Him, Jesus Christ.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. God is good, God is good. All that can stand, please stand, bow your head and close your eyes as we go to the Father in prayer. Father God, because of your grace and your mercy, we woke up this morning. Truly, we will say, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Father God, you are the Lord of lords, the King of kings, the Prince of peace, the bread of life, the light of this world. You are the Most High God, the Everlasting God, the Almighty God. Father, you are the God that provides for us. You are the God that protects us. You are the God that heals us. You are the God that comforts us. You are the God of grace and mercy. You are the God of victory. You are the God of love that loved us so much that you gave your only begotten Son, Jesus, who died and bled on the cross for our sins. Father God, we thank you that there is power in the blood of Jesus that wash, that cleanse, that delete, that erase, that remove all of our sins, and it does not matter what we did. We can start over again. We can become a brand new creature. Old things can pass away, and all things can become new. Father God, we thank you that it's not how we started, but it's how we finish. Father God, that same blood of Jesus give us power over the devil. When the devil comes with his plans, his plots, his games, his schemes, his devices, we just called on the name of Jesus. When the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy our life here on earth, we just call on the name of Jesus. Right now, during this pandemic that's sweeping the land, we call on the name of Jesus. Jesus in the morning. Jesus in the noon. Jesus at night. Jesus in the midnight hour. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Father God, I plead the blood of Jesus over Pastor Valerie Holcomb. From the crown of her head to the soles of her feet, every organ, every muscle, every tissue, every bone, every joint is working together as one as you made it, Father God. Father God, we thank you for our woman of God that give us a word, that give us correction, so we can grow and learn in your word. See, give us a word that give us instruction so we can live up in a down world. See, feed us with knowledge and understanding so we can know more about the God that we serve, and we can be more like you, Father. Father God, I plead the blood of Jesus over the eldership, the deaconship, the leadership, the membership, the ones that are streaming online. And Father God, as your word come forward this morning, I pray that souls will be saved, backsliders will come back home, and new members will be added to this church where it is all about him. Father God, I give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen, amen, and amen.
Hallelujah. Come on and give him the best praise you can. Come on, come on. Open up your mouth. Offer him up the fruit of your lips. For we serve a promise-keeping God. How many know that God is faithful to perform his word in your life? Hallelujah. And so this morning we're going to declare it is so. It is amen. Yes and amen to the glory of God. Hallelujah. Bless your name, Jesus.
Amen. up your hands and say,
yes, I love them all, yes, I do.
If you really love them, let me hear you clap your hands and say,
yes, I love them all, yes, I do.
If you really love them, let me hear you clap your hands and say,
yes, I love them all, yes, I do.
Bow down and say you are king. So let's start right now. Why would we wait? King of glory, fill this place. Just wanna be with you. Just wanna be with you. Just wanna be with you. y'all say.
Please stand as we declare the 91st Psalm. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wing shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. The Christian House of Prayer invites you to come and worship with us every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. Come and enjoy the Word, the worship, and the presence of God as we adjust to our new normal. We've taken all precautions and we're following CDC guidelines to make your worship experience as safe as possible. Interested in worshiping with us? Log on to chop.org tomorrow morning beginning at 9 a.m. and click the Reservations tab to reserve your seat. Upon arrival of service, please wear your mask and be prepared to have your temperature checked and sanitization complete before entering the service. The Christian House of Prayer is doing the practical to keep all of our members as safe as possible. Come worship with us next Sunday at the Christian House of Prayer Ministries, where it's all about Him, Jesus Christ. Just a friendly reminder, please remember to wear your mask during the entire service and practice social distancing during worship and as you move throughout the sanctuary. Thank you. For your convenience, Christian House of Prayer has made giving simple and easy. Give from your electronic devices online at chop.org or on the Chop app. Give by mail at P.O. Box 960, Coppers Cove, Texas, 76522. Give in person on Wednesdays in the foyer between the hours of 6 p.m. and 8 p.m. And we resume giving in the foyer on Sunday mornings from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. for those not registered to attend service. Give at our Cove location at 916 West Highway 190 on Mondays, Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. You may also give at the Covenant Savings Federal Credit Union's Night Depository Box 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, for your convenience. Let's continue to do the practical, and God will do the providential in this season. Early voting begins on October 13th and ends on October the 30th. Make plans to avoid the lines this election year and vote early. Log on to your county's website for polling locations and hours of operation. Join us online Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. for a hallmark message from our beloved Bishop Nate Holcomb. Rehearse a word that you've heard as we stay connected in this season. Log on to chop.org, cciCovenant.com, YouTube, and Facebook. Every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Attention parents, save the date. Our Heritage Kingdom is scheduled to be reopened on Sunday, November 1st. Detailed information coming soon. Christian House of Prayer has gone digital, and we've changed the way we're doing things, making it easy and convenient for you to access all media and ministry materials in one convenient location at chop.org. Once you're at chop.org, click on the Hymn Books tab and purchase today's message, along with your favorite messages and books from our beloved bishop, as well as our pastor, Valerie Holcomb. You may also subscribe, renew, and access your Sync Club account, all with one click. Give your tithes and offerings and gifts of love by clicking on the Give tab. Register for Sunday services by visiting the Service Registration tab. Stream live every Sunday morning and Wednesday evenings by clicking on the Watch Live tab, as well as connect to all of our social media sites and so much more. The Christian House of Prayer is making it easy for you to stay connected to what's going on here at the Christian House of Prayer by logging on to www.chop.org.
Good morning, Christian House of Prayer family. So good to be back together with you again, and we welcome you again to the living room of God. I want to share with you a scripture for offering this morning. It's being found in Genesis 50, the 20th verse and section B. It says, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it all for good. He brought me to this position so that I could touch the lives of many." Now I realize this is a fairly peculiar passage to use during an offertorial. However, the reference is to our spiritual response to the enemy that has utilized COVID-19 within the context of his plot, ploys, and plans. Is COVID-19 a good thing? Absolutely not. However, I want you to consider the allegories and the parallels as we go through and look at this thing. While everybody else was sheltering in place, the believers of God were sheltering in grace. And we continue to do so as God protects us under the protection of the assurance of Psalms 91 and the blood of Jesus Christ. I would consider the parallel being principles contrasting the enemy's strategy and God's predetermined plan. You see, three things to consider. First of all, COVID-19's transference is very interesting in that airborne particulate matter is what transmits this virus primarily. It's something that you cannot see. But as it relates to giving and sharing of your tithes and offerings in the house of God, when we transfer what God has given back to us, we sow seed. In other words, we give money. We are giving something physical that becomes a spiritual event, something that we cannot see. A second aspect I found interesting, COVID-19's multiplication. Unlike bacteria, a virus increases based on a host for reproduction. COVID-19 uses the lungs. But look at God's principle and plan for multiplying us, because God deals only with addition and multiplication. He never deals with subtraction and division. When we give, the replication or the multiplication of what we give is predicated also upon a host. the powerful, vibrant, ever active and living principles of the promises of God's word. Hallelujah. The last thing that I found interesting was COVID-19's impact. The virus's objective is to evolve from a respiratory event to a cardiovascular event affecting the blood, specifically the pulmonary functions of the lungs. But when you look at the effects of our giving, it's paralleled and far more profound. When the increase of both quality and quantity of our giving has taken place, the momentum has a blossoming effect, glory to God, of not just the blessings of the Lord overtaking us, but also blessing those of them that are around us, according to Deuteronomy 28, 1 through 8. If you have lost ground during this crisis as a result of various economic, employment, or financial factors, remember that all things are not good, but all things work together for good to them that love God, Romans 8 and 28. And what is the most tangible thing that you can do to show your love to God? By giving back to Him. His giving was sacrificial to us. He said that was our motto. That was our example. So listen, beloved, this morning, let us flip the script on the enemy. And let's use his strategy of using that pattern of COVID for our giving. Let us speak the word only and giving to him like you trust him. And this will be the pivotal key and the catalyst for you regaining the ground that you lost. Let us pray. Father, in Jesus' name, how thankful and how grateful we are for an opportunity to enter into your courts, your gates with thanksgiving, and into your court, enter into your courts with thanksgiving, and into the gates with praise. And we're thankful unto you, and we bless your name, and we come bearing gifts of praise, the sacrifices of our mouth, and also gifts of sacrifice, Lord, our tithes and our offerings. I've longed, Lord, to be able to give my tithes to you in your house. So, Lord, I pray that those of them that will be participating in this sacrificial act of love, those of them that are not paying but giving because of who you are, that you would cause blessings to be multiplied and increased upon your people as a result of their obedience to the living God, our King, in whom we trust both now and forevermore. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please submit your offering envelope in the offering box on the back walls as you exit the sanctuary. Thank you. Please stand as we declare our confession of faith. People are standing in line to get into this church to hear the word of God. Every seat is filled in every service with expectations of signs, wonders, and miracles. Our Sunday morning service at 10 o'clock in Killeen, our Wednesday night service at 7 o'clock in Killeen, and any other service that we might have. Every need in this ministry is met, and we are 100% tithe givers. All of our property is paid off in full, and we owe nothing to no man but to love. Every member of this church is healed, healthy, blessed, and prosperous, and we are reaching the world with the gospel through our prayers and support. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. And being fully persuaded that what he hath promised, he was able also to perform. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Hallelujah! 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 This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning, Christian House of Prayer. You are full of enthusiastic praise, spontaneous praise, burden removing, yoke destroying praise. Hallelujah. God inhabits the praises of his people. Good morning, Christian House of Prayer here, and good morning, Christian House of Prayer out there that's on streaming. We are so delighted to be among the living today. Hallelujah. We can lift up holy hands in the sanctuary. When we got up this morning, we knew who we were and who we belonged to. Amen. So let's praise the Lord for our deacon, Deacon Wilburn. Let's give God praise for our praise and worship, our sound department, our greeters, our ushers. Hallelujah. Our praise and worship. Everybody that have ministered this morning in any way, we say God bless you and thank you for allowing God to use you in a mighty way. Praise the Lord. Do we have any first time? Sit down just for a minute. Do we have any first-time visitors that are here this morning for the very first time? If you're here this morning for the very first time, would you please stand so we can see who you are? Stand up so we can see you. We have one. We have two. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We thank you all. Thank you all for coming here to the Christian House of Prayer this morning. We know you could have went to any church. You passed so many fine churches on your way here, but we are thankful and grateful that you saw fit to come worship with us here at the Christian House of Prayer. We call this the living room of God. And so whatever your need might be, I believe for everybody, before you leave, I believe that God will meet that need. For we're in the potter's house, and the potter wants to put us back together again. Amen. He wants to put us back. Whatever, if somebody's depressed, somebody's perplexed, somebody has lost hope, the potter wants to put you back. He's the only one that can do it. Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. All the king horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty back together again, but they didn't call for King Jesus. King Jesus can put you back together again. Amen. And I'm so happy. I'm so honored. I'm so honored to be your servant today. And I want to give my condolences to all those that have had loved ones that have passed away this week. It's been so many. And as you see, we put them up on the Jumbotron so that you'll be able to see who they are. The reason why I don't announce them a lot, because I don't want to miss anyone. And so we put them up there, and if your name is not up there, you let us know. But I want to do it today because I want us to I'm asking for special prayer to go up on the behalf of our loved ones all over. We have Marlene Marsher, her mother just passed away this morning. We have Roland Stewart, call him Big Stu. He's losing weight, so he's Little Stu now. His mother passed away. Lil Richardson, her sister passed away. Donna Spears, her mother passed away. Rose Coit, her brother passed away. Raymond Spivey, his mother passed away. Mother Jones, her grandson passed away. Jesse Gainey, his uncle passed away. These are our family members. And we want them to know that if they have prayed with us in our time of loss, and that we have sent up believing prayers for them. We want them to know, as they've done it for us, we want them to know that we will do it for them. Amen. We don't want to forget. These are our brothers and sisters. This is our family. And when they hurt, we hurt. When they rejoice, we rejoice. Amen. Amen. So, Father, I lift up the bereaved this morning. And I ask you to pour in the oil, pour in the wine, and give them recuperative strength for this journey. Father, we know that absent from the body, we are present with the Lord. But in our emotions, in our mind, in our hearts, Lord, it's still hurt. And so we're asking, Lord, for you to supernaturally allow something to be said or something to be done, a card, a phone call, or a meal that will be brought by, something that will encourage these that have lost their loved ones. Now, we know they're not lost. We know where they are, but they don't have them the way they had them. And so, Father, I'm asking you, Lord Father, to give them the peace that passes all understanding through your Holy Spirit. Your Spirit would hover over them and give them peace during this time. Father, as a Christian house of prayer, as this ministry, this is the Christian house of prayer. So we know how to pray, and we know how to pray. We know how to pray, and our prayers always are answered. God always answers our prayers. And so we thank you, Lord, and we praise you, and we give you all the glory. We give you all the honor, all the adoration, and thanksgiving. Lift up their heads. Lift up their countenance. And Father, even the family members that are unreasonable and those that will bring division, I say peace be in their homes and in their house as they would make preparations for the homegoing services of these loved ones. To God be the glory for the things that he has done, he's going to do, and that he's already done. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Let's give God a praise. Let's give him a praise. He's worthy. Let's stand to our feet and let us open up our Bibles to Romans chapter 12, verse 3, and also Proverbs chapter 6, verse 26. Romans 12, 3, and Proverbs 6, 26. Romans chapter 12, verse 3 reads, "For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think." Now, we ought to think highly, but he said not to think more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. Can we say that last part together? God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. Now let's go to Proverbs chapter 6, verse 26. "For the Lord shall be thy confidence and shall keep thy foot from being taken." From being taken. Amen? Amen. If I said the wrong scripture, take that down. We'll get it later. Amen. Hallelujah. The main thing is we can't depend on ourselves. We cannot depend on ourselves. Amen. I want us to say it together. We cannot depend on ourselves. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, the hearers, and the doers of his word. And let all God's people say amen and amen. Hallelujah. You may have your seats in the presence of our life-changing King. Jesus is the center and circumference, the base and the boundary, the balance and the beauty, the sum and the substance of what our lives are all about. It's all about Jesus. It's all about him. Now, we've been ministering in the axe head anointing. We need the axe head anointing. Now the axe head anointed, and I have to say this over and over again because we have new people that tune in, and we've had people that say, what is this axe head anointing? And even though I try to give the definition every week, but sometimes people come in and we want them to be online in the same vein that we're on, amen? So the axe head anointing represents the anointing of Jesus Christ. The axe head anointing is the cutting edge, is the ability that God has given to the Holy Spirit to lead us, guide us, direct us, to help us. It's the yoke destroying, burden removing power of God. It's like an axe head is a tool, right? An axe head is a tool that you can cut down the tree with it, you can cut down branches, you can cut down things out in your yard, you can cut wood with it. But if you had the handle of the axe head and you're trying to cut down a tree with the handle, there would be a lot of perspiration going in it, but it wouldn't be much getting done. And so the axe handle represents us trying to live our life without God. The axe handle represents us moving in and out of our life, throughout our life, trying to live in this life without God. The axe handle represents the cutting edge, the anointing of the Holy Spirit that would help us get the job done. We need the anointing of the Holy Spirit. We need it. It's not even do we want it. We have to have it. Because in order for us to love like God loves, in order for us to walk this Christian life, we need the help and the assistance of the Holy Spirit. Amen? And when we are born again, when we receive Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit comes to live within our hearts. And as we begin to grow, and as we, I believe, when I got saved, I wanted all of it. I wanted the whole enchilada. Because there's a difference between the Holy Spirit being in you, but it's a difference when the Holy Spirit has you. When there's an overflowing of the Holy Spirit. Amen. It's a difference between putting some water in a glass, and it could be a quarter full, it could be a halfway full, it's still water in the glass. But when you pour that water and it's overflowing, it comes out from the top and overflows, hallelujah, all over your life, all over your mind, all over your actions. See, the Holy Spirit, he don't want us to just have him. He want to have us. And he want us to overflow with him. Amen, amen. Get up in the morning, like the deacon said this morning. We get up in the morning, it's all Jesus. Because the Holy Spirit, he comes to bear witness that Jesus is Lord. He comes to bear witness that everything Jesus did is real. That Jesus is not the bunny rabbit. He's not Santa Claus. We're not going to wake up one morning and somebody tell you, that was Jesus. Jesus is not real. That's not. No, Jesus is real. He is real. And the Holy Spirit's job is to bear witness that Jesus Christ is Lord. And not only that, because we can know Jesus is Lord, but never live the victorious life that he's called us to live. And this is what the Axe Head Anointing series is all about. That we can live a victorious life in Jesus. A victorious life. Not just get up in the morning, put your clothes on, go to work, come back home. I'm talking about a victorious life. That when you get up in the morning, first of all, the devil will be terrified when you get up. Because he will know that everywhere you go, where darkness is, light will be dispersed. When you walk into your office, The devil knows that when you walk in the office, that everything that's not right is going to work together for the good. The devil knows that when you're walking in this victorious life, that nothing can come your way, nothing can happen in your life that's going to shake you, that's going to break you, that's going to cause you to go back. It's not, nothing can come in your life that's going to cause you to retreat, to give up. You're not going to go back. You're not going to fall back. But you're going to go forward when you're living in the victorious life. So the axe head anointing, when we say the yoke destroying, burden removing power of God, I'm talking about power that can move mountains. Power that can take you beyond the grave. Some people have had lost, people have passed away in their lives, and they've never been able to get up out the bed yet. And that's sad, because when we had the axe head anointing, we know that nothing, what will separate us from the love of God? Will parallel times, what bad times, will that separate? Will not having enough money, will not having a good health, what will separate us from the love of God? Nothing. Nothing when we're walking in the victorious life. Now, I want to start ministering, and I'm not going to finish this message today. I want to let you know already. We're going to pick it back up. Now, for some, this will be review. Some, it'll be new. But believe me, it's all true. But every time we talk, we think we don't need it. But every time we talk about it, we understand why. We want to talk about, in the next couple of weeks, headed to confidence, faith first. Faith first. When I left off a couple of weeks ago, I left off on victory in our new. And somebody also quoted 2 Corinthians 5 and 15. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. Jesus, when Jesus comes into our life, he gives us an opportunity not to be a nicer person, not to be a person that's turned over a new leaf in life, though all of that happens too. But he gives us a brand new life. A brand new life. And we talked about a new Lord, he's a new Lord. We have a new Lord. In other words, I'm not my Lord no more. Jesus is my Lord. So we have a new Lord in the new birth, under new management. We have a new light. We have divine illumination where Jesus, we will know not only that Jesus is Lord, but we'll be able to receive revelation. Revelation. We will have divine illumination. When we get born again, there's a new light. There's a new liberty where the Holy Spirit is in charge. The Holy Spirit not only will help us through the power of the Holy Spirit for us to turn down sin, but the power to be able to walk in righteousness. That we can walk in righteousness and holiness. I'm not talking about taking off this and taking off that. I'm talking about holy. Set apart for redemptive purposes, meet for the master's use, and prepare for every good work. We have a new liberty. We have a new love. We can love like Jesus loved. We can love those that don't love us. Amen. Matthew chapter 22, verse 37 and 38 says, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all of thy heart and with all of thy soul and with all of thy mind. He said, this is the first commandment. And second is unto thee is to love thy neighbor as thyself. It's a new love. We can love like that. But it starts off with loving God with all of our mind, all of our soul, all of our heart, all of our mind. Everything that's within us, we can love like God loves. A new labor, a passion for souls to be saved. Matthew chapter 9, verse 37 and 38, it says, Jesus said unto his disciples, the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. He said, pray therefore to the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into the harvest. Now, isn't it amazing that he said, pray to the Lord of preachers. Pray to the Lord. We don't have enough preachers. Well, we got preachers, but the preachers are not going out into the harvest. The laborers are few. And our labor is to see people saved. And so there is victory in our new. We have a new Lord. We have a new light. We have a new liberty. We have a new love. We have a new passion. Amen? And so when we know that we're new, we know. I tell you, I looked at my hands after I got saved. My hands couldn't do the things that they used to could do. I looked at my hands, they looked new. I looked at my feet and they did too. There's a new in our victory. It's a new in our salvation. Don't you love him? Don't you love him? He's the only one that can go back into our past and all the mess, all the stuff that we did. And he can forgive us for all that. Now, he's not senile. He know it happened. But he chooses not to remember it. He's cast it into the sea of forgetfulness. And he don't want to remember it no more. And so we have the opportunity to share our experience with somebody else. Amen. On last week, Elder Donnie Frith said, he talked about the anointing to overcome. And he said, this anointing that we have, if you don't have this anointing and you're not operating in it, it's like having a car and that don't have no gas in it. You're trying to drive a car that don't have no gas in it. We need the axe head anointing because we're saved. And God wants to drive us here. He wants to send us there. He wants to speak to that one over there. He wants us to get on the phone and call Bubba over there. And we got to have the gas of the anointing, the yoke-destroying, burden-removing power of God. I tell you, when I think about the work that need to be done, when I think about the people's lives are in the balance, I tell you, all I got to do is think about some of my family members. And the anointing starts to rise up. Now, that's fine. But what am I going to do about it? What am I going to do about it? Amen. And so we're headed to confidence. But before we get to confidence, we got to have faith first. Now, Jesus offers life to everyone that will accept him. And confidence, when we get to confidence, confidence is trust in him to help us to be delivered, to be developed, and to be directed. We need deliverance. How many people in here right now, even though you saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, you need deliverance in something? How many of us need development? How many of us need direction? confidence is an unwavering trust in the Father's love. Let's say that together. Confidence is an unwavering trust in the Father's love. But before we can have an unwavering trust in the Father's love, we got to have confidence in having faith in God. Now, many people that haven't been developed yet, they don't realize that faith and confidence are two different things. You see, we can have faith without confidence, but we can't have confidence without faith. Let me say it again. We can have faith without confidence, but we cannot have confidence without faith. I want that to sink down. Because God gives to every man the measure, every man, the measure of faith. We read it already in Romans chapter 12 and verse 3. He didn't say that he give every born again believer the measure of faith. He give everybody that's born into this world, he gives everybody the measure of faith. Now, even as a baby begins to practice that as a little baby. That baby start crying, it figures that out. If I keep crying, I got faith enough that I'm going to get that bottle. I'm going to get that milk. I'm going to get that pacifier. If I cry enough, maybe they'll change the stinky diaper I got on. They don't know it, but they're operating in faith. They don't realize it, but they're operating in faith. Now, we need that measure, and that measure, it grows from one thing to the next. We need the measure of faith to be saved. We need that measure of faith to trust God. We need that measure of faith to receive the ministry of the Holy Spirit. We need the measure of faith for God for us to allow the Holy Spirit to transform our mind. We need that measure of faith. But even though everybody has that measure, the ultimate is that God has given us that measure of faith so that we can receive Him as our personal Lord and Savior. Because no matter where we have put our faith, no matter how we have used our faith, the ultimate is that we would have faith in God. That's the ultimate. Because we can have faith in the government. We can have faith in mama. We can have faith in papa. We can have faith in you know, uncle who it is. We can have faith in everybody else. And that's fine, because there are certain things that God uses people for people. He does. He uses people for people. But the ultimate is we must have faith in God. Now, Romans 12 and 3, it says, God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. But I want you to turn over to 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 2. We must have faith in God. Faith in God. We need faith for everything. See, we have to train our heart to believe by teaching our mouth what to speak, that transform our mind to think positively. See, we need all of that. Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 2 says, and that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men, for all men what? Now, this looks like this is a contradiction of Romans chapter 12, verse 3, where it says, he's dealt to every man the measure of faith. Now, here it says, for all men have not faith. And what this simply means is all men have not faith in God. It doesn't mean that all men don't have faith, but all men don't have faith in God. Now, I want you to turn with me in your Bible over to 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5. 1 Timothy 1 and 5. And you can write this down. Romans 1 and 17. Time is going by so fast. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Say that together with me. The just shall live by faith. Now go to 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 5. Now, Thessalonians says that all men have not faith. All men have not faith in God, and all men don't have real faith. All men don't have real faith. 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 5 says, now the end of the commandment is charity. Charity is love. Out of a pure heart and of a good conscience and of faith unfeigned. Say that word, unfeigned. Now, unfeigned faith is the real kind of faith. It's the faith in God. It's the faith in God. It's the faith that has learned and through experience. And sometimes, you know, I was telling somebody the other day, I said, you know, I've always been the kind of a person, I didn't have to experience everything. I can learn from other people's mistakes. Amen. And if I, you know, somebody, I can learn, okay, after I saw this one, this happened to this one because they did that. And this happened to this one because they did that. I don't have to do that. Because I don't, you know, I'm not going to do that. And so there is a such thing as feigned faith. See, unfeigned faith is real faith, is the real McCoy, is the real deal. Now, unfeigned faith is the fake faith, is the phony faith, is the faith, is so phony. It doesn't bring forth no fruit. See, real faith will bring forth fruit. We know over in Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22, it talks about the fruit of the Spirit. And the fruit of the Spirit is love. We just saw up there where it says, now the end of the commandment is love. So if there is fruit, real fruit, because of real faith in God, we're going to have the fruit of the Spirit. We're going to have, because we're going to have joy. Joy is love strength. We're going to have peace. It's love safety. We're going to have long suffering. It's love's patience. We're going to have gentleness. It's love's conduct. We're not going to act the way we used to act. We're going to have love's goodness. That's love's character. We're going to have faithfulness. That's love's loyalty. We're going to have some faithfulness, love's loyalty. So if you couple that together, even with real faith, that means we're going to be loyal to God by having faith in God. Meekness is love's humility. Temperance is love's victory. And mercy is the proof of love. Amen. And when we have real faith, I'm not talking about pretend faith. See, that's feigned faith. That's the fake kind of faith. That's the kind of faith that, you know, the person is knee-high in debt. They owe on everything. Trying to follow the Joneses. They got the big car. They got several of them. All kinds of stuff. But they haven't walked by faith. They just got in debt. See, if you're operating in real faith, you can pay for it. You can pay for it. You can pay for it when it's real fruit. See, phony fruit is a pretend. It's not real. And with God, when we have faith in God, the proof is in the eating. You're going to see some real fruit, not manufactured fruit. See, when it's manufactured fruit, I can have a big bowl of fruit, a big bowl that got plastic fruit in it. And when you bite down into that big old apple plastic fruit, it ain't nothing but some clay. It ain't nothing but some soil. It's not the real deal. Real fruit has to grow. And it takes time to grow. Real fruit, if the seed is in the ground, see, some of you are not on the same level. We all in the same, on a different level of our Christian walk in this place. Some people are just starting off in their faith. Some people have been in it a while, and now they decided that they're going to redeem the time and they can catch up. One thing that I like about our salvation growth is we don't have to wait for nobody else. It's up to us what we want to do. But feigned faith, which is the fake faith, it can't stand the test of time. It can't stand when the trials and the tribulation and persecution come. Because the winds will come and the rains will come. And trials and temptation and tests will come and will beat up against all of our houses. But those that have their faith in God will not fall. Hey, we might wibble wobble, but we won't fall down. It might knock us down, but we're going to get up. When you have your faith in God, it doesn't matter what life may bring us, because we got the real deal. The real deal. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 2, Hebrews 4 and 2, it says, unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. Some do, some don't, some will, some won't. Even in this place, one out of four people in here is going to get this word today, and they're going to take this word, and there's going to be a change in their life for the better. Some do, some don't, some will, some won't. We got to decide which one are we going to be. Because those that don't, the fakes, the phonies, they the they says. They say tithing went out with the early church. They say healing is not us for us today. Hallelujah. You know, I'm tired of reading about Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I want to see the God of Valerie Holcomb. I want to see the God of Christian House of Prayer. I want to see the blinded eyes open. I want to see the lame walk. I want to see the minds come back to where it's supposed to be. I want to see the marriages hold on. If it's just a little flicker of the bick, God can change it and turn it around. See, the real McCoy won't give up. The real McCoy would say, if I die, let me die. But I'm not giving up. But see, the phony, the pretend, the pretenders are those that can shout the loudest, quote the scriptures, tell you what you shouldn't do. But when the heat is on, when the heat is on, there was a monk. That clock not moving, I'm glad. There was a monk by the name of Martin Luther back in October the 3rd, 1517. He started a reformation And it had got so heated with him. God used him. And it got so heated, they threw him out the church. They threw him out. But it was three messages that God gave him a revelation that is by faith alone. It's by faith alone. See, the knower, the Holy Spirit, our spirit, the real us, we know that Jesus is Lord. See, we never saw Golgotha's hill. I've been to Israel twice. But I still don't, it was Golgotha's hill. It's even hard to even imagine it. I've been down to the river, to the Jordan River, to the Dead Sea. They say all that stuff happened. I wasn't there. But see, we have the measure of faith to believe that it happened. Because in us, there is an intuitive witness that Jesus is Lord and it happened. And Martin Luther got a hold of it. God got a hold of his mind. He got a hold of his spirit. And he said, faith is by faith alone. He said, it's by grace alone. By grace are we saved. Through faith. And he said, it's by scripture alone. And he said, it's because of the love of God and the love that God has for all people. See, they was telling Luther, God don't love all people. And that same spirit is here today. And that's the reason why the people of God, we got to have a new light. We got to be able to see. We have to be able to see what's really there. See that fame, faith is phony. It's not the real deal. Back in the 80s, when the charismatic renewal came about, and Martin Luther, he brought that revelation, and it was high. He got persecuted for it, but it stuck. But as time went on, people wasn't preaching about faith. They weren't preaching about faith. They wasn't preaching about our power, our rights that we have, the inheritance of the saints, the anointing of the believer. You didn't hear it. You mainly heard, we need to be saved. We mainly heard, you got to take off this, you got to take off that. It was mainly dealing with the duty. You know, we have the doctrine, and then we have the duty. Now, sometimes people say, you know, we got to have the form and the fashion. We got to have that form and fashion too. We should know what to put on. We should know what to take off. We should know how to look like a woman of God and a man of God. We should know that. But that's not the gospel. The gospel is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's the gospel. And the gospel says that if we receive him as our personal Lord and Savior, that he has a plan for our life. Now, the plan that he had for my life might not be the plan he got for your life. But he has a plan. And it has a good expected end. We're going to be satisfied. We're going to be able to thank him for the life that he's given us. Amen? But back in the 80s, talking about this unfeigned faith, and this feigned faith, this phony faith, there was a female minister. You didn't have a lot of them back then, in the 80s. And the charismatic renewal came into existence, we call it. And some people today that don't understand, even back, still getting persecuted. The name it, claim it, people. The name it and the claim it. Yeah, I'm going to name it Jesus Christ, and I'm going to claim it Jesus Christ. It's all about him. You know, the devil try to make you feel like you ain't worshiping God, naming it and claiming it. That's the word of God. He said you had not because you asked not. And when you ask sometime, you ask in a miss. You don't ask with the real kind of faith. And so it poured out, God poured out his spirit all over the land. And those that was worshiping God in spirit and in truth and was preaching the word of that time and of that time. That's why we have to know the seasons and the times. We can't be preaching something. We know all the word. This word is the word from the contents to the map. But there are certain words that God would give that's relevant for that time and for that season. And so it poured out, and there was conferences all over, everywhere. Conferences here, conferences everywhere. Charismatic churches were full to the brink. Everybody was coming. And people weren't coming for the right reasons. We know that. Some people were coming for the cars. Some people were coming for the money. Money is the lowest form of prosperity. But we need money to live, to promulgate the gospel. But they were coming from everywhere. And there was this lady. She started preaching and had a good word. She had a good word. But see, the supernatural, sometimes when our faith is not in God and we're looking for something spectacular, we're looking for something to satisfy our soul, our flesh, not our soul, our flesh, itching ears. She began to move off into some areas that she shouldn't have been in. And she began to say some things that she shouldn't have said. That's the reason why he said, we cannot think of ourselves more higher than we ought to think. We got to remain humble. We got to remain humble. We got to let him always be in center front. She began to say, women, y'all don't have to take no birth control pills no more. She said, use your faith. Just use your faith. Use your faith. Just believe, just use your faith. Just, I believe I'm not going to get pregnant. Oh, it was wild back there. It was some wild stuff. People was believing gold in their teeth. If they had a cavity, they didn't. I'm not going to the dentist. Stand in the mouth, in the mirror. I believe I got my teeth. I lied to you not. It was foolishness. Unfeigned, not the real deal. Fame, foolishness, phony. And after a while, those women stopped taking the birth control pills. They stopped doing what they did. I don't know what they did, but I know what I did. People started getting pregnant. And they were disappointed. Well, what is it? Is it that I'm not using my faith right? And see, this has been confusion in the body of Christ because we think we got to have faith in our faith. It's not faith in our faith. It's faith in God, in God alone. See, because, well, maybe the reason why I didn't get that promotion is because my faith wasn't up to par. Maybe I didn't pray long enough. Maybe I didn't. It's always what I didn't. We have to have faith in God. And these women, they got pregnant. And they start sending her letters. Look, I believed I received it. And I'm pregnant. What happened? She prayed. You're not. You got sin in your life. You got sin in your life. You need to repent. And once you repent, You'll be able to operate in this. Well, that went on for a minute. And after a while, after it got, it was a wildfire. I didn't stop taking mine. I'm telling y'all, I didn't stop taking mine. But one of her armor bearers came up and said, she take birth control pills every day. This woman takes birth control pills every day. Now, I'm sharing this because I want to show you what phony faith is. And she came and she acknowledged that she did it. She did it. She got hung up in it. She got hung up in the hype. She got hung up in the applause. She got hung up on the pats on the backs. She got the hung up on me. Look, me. See, anybody that's in a hurry, God ain't called you. You might have a gift, but if you're in a hurry, you better watch out. Because everybody that I've ever seen God use, they running from their calling. God got to go get them, hog them down, and tie them up and bring them in. And so we can't think of ourselves more higher than we ought to think, because if we do, we will have our faith in ourselves. We'll have our faith in something else other than God. In Matthew chapter 17, you don't have to turn there. This is the account when Jesus was confronted by a man. The man fell down at Jesus' feet and said, Lord, have mercy on my son. He said, my son is vexed. He said, he falls in the water and he falls in the fire. He said, and I came to your disciples and they could not cure him. They couldn't cure him. They could not help my son. And Jesus said over Matthew 17:17, he said, oh, faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? He said, bring them to me. And they brought the boy to Jesus, and Jesus rebuked the devil. And that devil departed out of that boy within that selfsame hour. And afterward, his disciples came to him and said, Jesus, why could we not cast that devil out? Matthew 17, verse 20 and 21 says, and Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief, for verily I say unto you, if you shall have faith as a grain of mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, remove hence and to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. He said, howbeit, this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting. Now the praying and the fasting, it don't wrestle God's arm. It gets us in the position to believe. And this is where the axe head anointing comes in, because it's when it takes us beyond the natural. I have a burden, y'all. I have a burden in my spirit. I don't want to just come to church and we just hear a word. And we go back home and put the word on the table and just leave it there. And, you know, and us as ministers, we go on the word just to get a message. I'm talking about casting out devils. I'm talking about healing the sick. When we have faith in God, I'm talking about the unfeigned faith. Anything worth doing is worth doing bad until you can do it better. And somebody might say, well, what if, you know, we've been believing, we've been praying, and a lot of us been healed. I've been healed. But don't you want to see it more? Don't you want to see more lives saved? Don't you want to see your neighborhood saved and sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost? See, there is a faith, this unfeigned faith, this real McCoy that keeps us thirsty. It keeps us thirsty and wanting more of God. Lord, I want to know you more. Lord, I want to know you more. I want to be in your presence. I want to feel your anointing. I want to be able to see the fruit of my life. I want to see the gentleness. I want to see the loyalty. I want to see my strength be developed. See, faith in God. Actually, if you just want to say a word, just one word for faith, just one word, it's belief. I believe God is. And since I believe God is, I believe that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. All faith is, I believe. If you got hired, if you don't have a job and you got hired on tomorrow, and you got hired and you came in, you went down there, you got to put your best suit on, put your best dress on, went down there and you sat there and talked to them like you got some sense, some common sense, because sometimes we lose our common sense. And they come out there and they hire you. And they'll begin, okay, you hired. You hired. You hired, Brother Sherman. You hired. All right, I'll see you later. You say, I'm hired. All right, what time am I supposed to be at work? How much do I get paid? See, the moment you got hired, that's when faith began to kick in. Because here's a stranger, somebody you ain't never knew, you know, you don't even know that person. And they've offered you a job, telling you they're going to pay you $15,000 a month. And you don't know this man. You never saw his bank account. You don't know whether he jacked the Ripper. You don't know his lifestyle. You don't know whether he's a womanizer. You don't know what he is. But you take the word of a stranger that you got this job and I'm going to pay you $15,000 at the end of a month. In 30 days, you're going to get $15,000. You know what Sherman going to do? He going to come to work on time. He going to go down there to the Mercedes dealer and start picking out his car that he gonna get. He's already making plans because God, you see, faith lives off the promises of God. Faith lives off the promises of God. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. We're gonna talk about that next week. But see, he is operating in faith with somebody he don't even know. We know God. We know what he has done for us in our lives. We know what we were before we got saved. We know what we were capable of. And God has done all that he has done for us. Why can't we take him at his word? The real kind of faith is the faith that says, God, it doesn't matter what it looked like. It doesn't matter what it seems like. It doesn't matter what it looks like. Everywhere I look, I'm telling you, it's a man that I've been, Bishop knew who this man was. This is a man from way back, real old. Real old man. Don't think nothing funny going up in here. Real old. Real old. I said, even if I wanted a husband, I had to be a cougar. Now y'all pick that up later. He said, I'm so nervous. He said, I'm so nervous. I'm still frisky. So I want no old man. Don't get old on me. I tell Solomon all the time. I tell Solomon mostly. I mess with him. I say, you still a young lion? He said, even an old lion could still hunt. I said, that's right, Solomon. But he said, I'm so nervous. He said, everything that's going on. As he's a designer. He's a well-known designer. Some of y'all would even know his name if I called it out. This outfit that I have on right now, he designed this. These outfits that I wear like this, he designs them. He sends me a great big box and has all the, don't have to send him no money. He sends it to me and I pick it out and then I send back what I don't want. But he says, I'm nervous. He said, everything that's going on, everything that's happening. He said, but I talked to you and you had the joy of the Lord. He said, your husband then passed away and everything. He said, and you happy? I said, because I have faith in God. My faith is in God. I said, you can have this joy. I said, I'm gonna get one of our male elders. He said, why can't I talk to you? I said, no, I want one of our male elders to talk to you. Because I'm not gonna be your crutch. I'm not gonna be your God. Have faith in God. Come on, you can do better than that. You can do better than that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I can go on, but I'm going to stop here. I tell y'all, God is, he's assembling an army. Y'all, see, if y'all go back, all the way back, I'm talking about doing leaders that lead and all kinds of things. And God has given me prophecies and has told y'all certain things. And y'all know I'm not saying nothing if God ain't told me to say it. If I ain't got nothing to say, I ain't saying nothing. But God is raising up an army. I'm telling you, he's raising up an army. And it's going to be like Central Texas ain't never seen. I'm telling you. It's going to be like Central Texas has never been seen before. And he's going to use ordinary people. Just like us. Ordinary people. People that's not trying to make a reputation for themselves. Just people that want God to be glorified. And people to be saved. You're going to be able to see the difference. And you're going to be able to just pray. You're going to see the unfeigned and you're going to see the fame. But God going to give you the wisdom to speak when it's time to speak. He's going to give you the wisdom to close your mouth when it's time to close your mouth. And we're going to see him do. See, Bishop didn't get a chance to see the fullness of what God had showed us, me and him. He didn't see it. He didn't see the fullness of it. But he saw it like Martin Luther King. He said, I'm not going to be there when it happened. He said, but it's going to happen. It's going to happen. And we're going to see it. We're going to see it with our own eyes. We're going to see the coming of the glory of the Lord. We're going to see him high and lifted up. His train Not only will it's going to fill this temple, but it's going to fill all the churches that believe and have their faith in God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. He's more than enough. He's more than enough. Every head bowed and every eye closed. If there is someone here this morning and you do not know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, you cannot say right now, unequivocally, if you were to die at this very moment, that you would be headed to heaven, that heaven is not your home. We're all pilgrims passing through. This is not our home. Heaven is a home. If you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, we've been talking about faith this morning. And we said that God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. And right now, you have enough faith to believe God is your personal Lord and Savior. You have enough faith to receive Him into your life that He can make a difference in your life. If you're not born again, if you're not saved, and you want to be saved, I want you to stand up. Stand to your feet right now and put your hands up high in the air. Lift up your hands high up in the air. High up in the air. Can you just take it down just a little bit? If you're here this morning and you've fallen away from God, you're not serving Him like you used to. The joy that you used to have, you don't have that joy any longer. The way you used to like to get up in the morning and sing the songs of Zion and pray and read the word, come to church. Now it just seems like it just doesn't have that kind of effect on you. That means you're in a backslidden state, but that's okay because God is married to the backslider. He's not divorced you. Your sin has separated you between you and your God. And if you want to come back to Him today, you have to make a bold step. And you got to walk over the devil and let the devil know, you're not going to reign on my life no more. I'm going with the Lord. And if that's you today and you want to come back to the Lord, I want you to make your way up to the front. I want you to come out, get your Bible, get your purse, and make it. Don't move yet. Don't move yet, counselors. Don't move yet. I want you to make your way up to the front. If you're in a backslidden state and you need to come to the front, you need to come by faith. I want you to come right now. I want you to come. Amen. Those of you that are on this, watching on streaming, if you need to receive Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, if you need to come back to the Lord, then you need to make your way to that telephone. Make your way to the telephone. And at the end of the service, we have numbers on the screen. You can call. And we have counselors that will minister to you the salvation prayer. And you will be born again. One more invitation I want to give to those that are out there and those that are here. And I know that it's mostly family here, but I don't want to be presumptuous and think that everybody here is saved and everybody is right with God here. But if there's someone that is here that do not have a church home, and you're looking for a church home, and you believe, you feel and you sense in your spirit that this is your church, the Christian House of Prayer is your church. I am your pastor and these are your people. Then I want you to make your way to the front. And those of you that are there also, if you want to join the Christian House of Prayer, you don't have to wait till we get back into the sanctuary. You can join the Christian House of Prayer right now. The only requirement that you have is that you must be born again. You must be born again. Amen and amen. While every heart is clear and that we are all right with God here, I'm gonna say it one more time. If you're not right with God, God forbid, I'm not trying to fill this altar. I'm trying to get you right with God before you start off your week, before you start off the rest of your day. I see you coming. See, this is the Potter's house. This is the Potter's house. Anybody else? You're going to have a better week if you get it right now. You're going to have a better week if you get it right now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, sisters. Thank you for your obedience. After service, we're going to get with them after service, okay? Why ain't God good? Ain't he good? And he is good. Hallelujah. One thing that I want to encourage each and every one of you to do, you know, right now, because we're coming back, we're in this phase, we have to bring the people. We have to bring them because they don't know if when it's time to come. They don't know if they could come. So you have to bring them. So let's, this week, let's activate our faith. We know we activate our faith by what? We activate our faith by doing something, saying something, or giving something. So let's activate our faith this week and bring somebody to church because somebody need to be saved. Amen? I love y'all. I love you. I love you with all of my heart. And I tell you, you're one of the greatest people on the planet of this earth. You're my people. And I thank God that God has saw fit to make me be numbered with you. Hallelujah. Now may the grace and the peace of God, our Father, and Jesus Christ be with you. From now, when you leave out this door, when you get in your car, as you go about your activities this week, may the grace of God be with you. Tell somebody that Jesus Christ is Lord. You are dismissed. God bless you. You can't have my breakthrough. You can't have my. You can't. You can't. You can't.